Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Combat Zone, Murder, Race, and Boston's Struggle for Justice by Jan Brogan, narrated by Donna Postel. A note on language. The 1970s is a particularly difficult time for racial issues in Boston, and racial language was prevalent. Some of the actual language used in this time period has been altered, when possible, without glossing over the relevant history. Chapter 1. A Night in the Zone. On a cold night in November 1976, at the end of an up-and-down season, the varsity football team gathered at the Harvard Club, in accordance with tradition. Under crystal chandeliers, the students dined on roast beef and green beans as they listened to speeches about brotherhood and accepted awards for their accomplishments. Princeton Heisman Trophy winner Dick Kazmaier gave the principal address, and Robert F. Kennedy's widow Ethel made a special trip to present an award in honor of her husband. But the more powerful speeches came from inside the team, from the coaches and the captain, who talked about the special bonds formed over double sessions, bus travel, and games that did not go as planned. Everything about Harvard football was steeped in tradition, from the century-old rivalry with Yale to the little red flag waved each time the Crimson scored. It reminded the boys of the storied history of Ivy League football and the privilege of playing for Harvard. Andy Puopolo, one of the seniors who had hung up his shoulder pads for the last time, ate the roast beef and sipped a Coke. He'd been pulled from Saturday's game against Yale with a mild concussion and had to be careful about how much alcohol he drank. It didn't matter. According to his friends and family, he was not much of a drinker. He had dark hair that fell below his ears in the overgrown style of the 70s, and green eyes, often described as intense. Although relatively short for a football player at 5'10", he was muscular from long hours spent in the gym, originally scoffed at by the Harvard interviewer when he said he wanted to play football. He'd worked hard to bulk up and had fought through injuries to win a starting position. But now, his playing days were over, and he was looking to the future. After the game loss on Saturday, he had surprised his parents by announcing he received his first acceptance to medical school. Andy had had his share of glory: 2 interceptions in the game against UPenn and a mention in the New York Times. But it had been a disappointing season for the team. Picked as the favorite to win the Ivy League championship, Harvard had ended up not just behind the 2 co-champions, Yale and Brown, but tied with Dartmouth for 2nd place. After dinner, the students went downstairs to the vaulted ceiling and dark Tudor wainscoting of the lounge. They milled around, drinking draft beer and bantering, as they watched the highlight reels. By the end of the official Harvard banquet, they were ready to shake off defeat. Just under 50 of the football players left the hallowed halls of the Harvard Club and descended on Boston's combat zone. They went to the Naked Eye, a strip club best known for its all-college girl review and its logo, an eye that winked over a backside view of upside-down and bare female legs. One of the teammates was related to the manager and had arranged to reserve the private room in back for their own show. By all accounts, the teammates, who arrived dressed up in their 3-piece suits and loafers, had a great time. After 2 of them climbed on stage to dance with the stripper shortly before last call, the bouncers announced it was time for the boys to go home. A Night in the Zone was an end-of-season tradition for Harvard's football team, as well as a common end-of-year practice by other Boston College football teams. But the timing this year was extremely questionable. The combat zone, which had made headlines for police corruption and escalating crime only the week before, was at the peak of its lawlessness. Restricted by law to a four-block area between the downtown crossing and Chinatown, the red light district was crammed with strip clubs, X-rated movie houses, adult bookstores, and a gay bathhouse. Years before the advent of the video cassette recorder, VCR, and a decade before the internet, men formed long lines outside the peep shows where a quarter kept the porn reel going. Prostitutes swarmed the streets and created a gridlock on weekends as they stopped cars and fondled men through open car windows. Dealers sold pot and heroin curbside. Mobsters and cops drank together at the bars as the muggers rolled drunks on the alleys outside. But the recklessness of the zone, the unpredictability, was part of its allure. The neon marquees cast both a glow and a shadow over littered sidewalks that pulsed with excitement, crime, and danger. As the Harvard students spilled out into the street, they broke into smaller groups, heading for taxis and cars. One of these groups, six Harvard students, accompanied by the Harvard equipment manager, passed by the Carnival Lounge on the way back to the Harvard van. Although they were dressed like lawyers, these men were young and loud, and at least one drunkenly off-kilter. Two of the young women standing outside the Carnival Lounge had prior arrests for both prostitution and theft. Cassandra McIntyre, still a girl at 16, was barely 5 feet tall and had a keloid scar running the length of her right cheek. Naomi Axel, the veteran at 22, was long and lean, wearing a wig and a long rust-colored leather coat. They approached the eight men passing by. The two prostitutes were black, and the three Harvard football players at the front of the line were also black. They regarded the women stonily. In the second year of court-ordered busing, racial tension in this segregated city was at its peak. As one of these three men would recall years later, they wanted no trouble with the cops or with anyone else on a Boston city street. They told the prostitutes to get lost and encouraged their teammates to do the same. But Naomi and Cassandra were already weaving between the other young men, reaching for their crotches. Recent publicity in both the city's two largest newspapers about the zone's pickpockets who lifted wallets while they fondled genitals made a couple of the other boys wary, but not all of them. As a few of the students would later testify, a conversation began. Rates were discussed. The two women followed the boys back to the Harvard equipment van. Neither Andy Puopolo nor Tommy Lincoln were a part of this group. Both pre-med students, they were facing exams later that week and were halfway down the street, almost a block away, anxious to get home. Offered a ride by a fellow teammate, they made it back to his Chevy Nova. Andy would even get inside, taking a seat in back. But within 15 minutes, as hell broke loose on Boylston Street over a stolen wallet, these two football players were stabbed, Andy critically. Three black men were arrested at the scene and charged with assault with intent to murder. The news of this violent end to the Harvard football season went around the country, horrifying parents of college-aged children. The early headlines would focus on the outrage over crime and violence in the out-of-control combat zone. But this was the year when Boston established its reputation as the most racist city in the nation, when angry parents rioted in the streets and pelted buses full of schoolchildren with rocks, when a black student stabbed a white one in the high school library, and when student demonstrators attacked a black businessman with an American flag. Race was a part of every story, every argument. The stabbings would lead to the cleanup of Boston's controversial red light district and be an important factor in its eventual demise. The trials would change the way juries were chosen in Massachusetts and influence a federal Supreme Court decision on jury selection years later. The Andrew Puopolo murder was the most highly publicized murder story in Boston in the 1970s. Wildly varying verdicts, only 2.5 years apart, would reflect changes in the city and prove that criminal trials aren't always about the victim, the accused, or even the crime when the forces in play are trying to right a completely different wrong. Chapter 2. Combat Medicine. In the early morning, as doctors worked on Andy Puopolo, the emergency room lounge at Tufts New England Medical Center began to fill with football players who had followed the police cruiser from the combat zone, and with cops who lingered in the hallway as a hospital administrator tried to impose order on the growing crowd. Decades later, Danny Puopolo, who had just turned 19, would recall being awakened from a deep sleep when the phone rang. His mother's cry jolted him awake. He heard footsteps in his parents' bedroom and his father's voice on the phone. Within seconds, his father was at his doorway, telling Danny to get up. Andy was in the hospital. He'd been stabbed in a fight, and it was bad. Only 22 months apart, the two brothers were extremely close. They had shared a bedroom since infancy in the family's tiny North End apartment, and through adolescence, when they had moved to the three-bedroom, multi-leveled house in Jamaica Plain. Even when their older sister, Fran, married and moved out, leaving an extra bedroom, the boys opted to stay together. Andy, who came home from Harvard nearly every weekend, had slept in the matching single bed just 2 nights before, as he recovered from a concussion he'd suffered during the Harvard-Yale game. Now, groggy from sleep and spinning into shock, Danny refused to believe the news. His first act was to throw on sweatpants and grab the keys to the 1975 Cutlass he and Andy shared. He wanted to get to the hospital to convince himself that his brother's injuries weren't that bad. But at the front door, his mother's cries made him stop and turn. Helen Puopolo, already dressed, stood at the top of the half flight of stairs, her eyes fearful. She didn't want her youngest, barely awake and in shock, careening through the city streets at this hour. She begged Danny to wait for them so they could drive together. His father appeared behind her and asked Danny to call his sister and her husband and tell them to meet at the hospital. The knife wounds were deep. The emergency room doctor had to cut open Andy's chest and massage his heart to revive him. The hospital's top cardiac and thoracic surgeons had been summoned from their homes, and when the family arrived at the hospital, Andy was about to be moved upstairs for more permanent repairs to his lung and heart. Andrew Sr., a quiet man who carried himself with the bearing of a former Marine, asked if he could just see his son. He recalled that a nurse escorted him into the trauma room and allowed him a fleeting glance. Unconscious on the stretcher, Andy's packed chest was covered by a blood-stained hospital gown. Tubes came out of his throat, groin, and neck. Andrew Sr. steadied himself and returned to the waiting room. He told Helen and Danny what the doctors had told him. They were lucky. Police had gotten Andy to the hospital just in the nick of time. The lounge in the emergency room grew loud as teammates and friends continued to swarm in. A hospital administrator pulled Danny and his parents aside and guided them through the emergency room to a lounge in the Pratt Farnsworth building, near the intensive care unit where Andy would be moved after surgery. Built into the corner of the building, the semi-hexagonal room was called the solarium. Large windows dominated three angled walls and looked out onto the dark and silent street. For the next several hours, the family waited in the oddly shaped room that was furnished with two small couches and a dozen hard-backed chairs. Helen Puopolo sat stiffly next to her husband. Normally a stylish woman, well-coiffed, she was a young-looking 47, but tonight, her eyes, the same green Andy had inherited, were aged with fear. A deeply religious woman, she'd had no time to grab her rosary beads, which later would become a fixture. She prayed silently, her empty hands white-knuckled, while her husband tried to keep her calm by assuring her that their son would make it through. Andrew Sr. had been an athlete in his youth, a boxer in the Marines. He was still fit at 52 and sat at attention in the uncomfortable chair, sipping weak coffee from the vending machine. Fran and her husband Paul, driving in from the suburbs, arrived half an hour after the rest of the family. Although all three children looked alike, the resemblance was striking between Andy and Fran, who had the same intense eyes and sharp cheekbones. Fran was the firstborn, the built-in babysitter, and she still worried about her younger brothers. She told the Boston Herald that she'd been having bad dreams about Andy before the stabbing, that a woman pointed to him and said, "You will be killed." When she told Andy about the dream, he'd assured her with, "Don't worry, Fran, I can take care of myself." Danny took his sister by the arm and steered her out of the solarium and down the hall so he could explain what happened out of earshot from their mother, who didn't need to hear it again. Unshaven and rumpled in the sweatpants and sweatshirt he'd found on the bedroom floor, Danny was a couple of inches shorter than Andy, stockier, and barrel-chested. He wasn't the same kind of athletic star as his brother, lacking the intense focus, but he was strong and quick, an avid recreational boxer. He'd taken down more than one opponent with his fists. Since the call from the hospital, he'd been cursing himself for not having been with Andy that night. He told his sister that Andy had asked him to meet up with the football players at the strip club for drinks, and he'd refused. Fran couldn't understand why either of them would want to go to the combat zone. Danny explained that, after the breakup dinner, the Harvard football team always went to a combat zone strip club for one last drink together, that it was tradition. At this hour, office doors on either side of the hospital corridor were sealed tight. The only sounds came from the nurse's station and the hum of machines in the ICU, as Danny explained why he hadn't agreed to meet up with Andy that night. He'd wanted him to enjoy a last night out with his team without having to look out after his younger brother. But now he was convinced that if he had gone, Andy would have been so worried about him that he would have gotten the two of them out of there at the first sign of any fighting. Across town, at Massachusetts General Hospital, surgical residents surrounded Tommy Lincoln in the trauma room and debated exploring the wound to determine the extent of damage. Later, when he himself was a doctor, Tom Lincoln, no longer called Tommy, would recall how, luckily, an older, wiser attending surgeon had been called in to examine the wound. It was just below the liver. The attending advised against an unnecessary surgery. Still charged with adrenaline, Tommy had little pain and was confused about why the doctors didn't just let him go home. He also didn't understand why uniformed police officers were in the hallway guarding him. Because he'd been dispatched to Mass General in an ambulance before the police had caught any of the three men who would be charged, Tommy had no idea that the police were actually there to guard 33-year-old Eddie Suarez, who had been transported to the same hospital for treatment of knuckle scrapes he'd gotten while fighting Andy. Tommy was stunned when the police brought the short, stocky man, his hand bandaged, to the end of his hospital bed, along with another black man, 36-year-old Richie Allen, a muscled powerhouse who worked as a bouncer at the Carnival Lounge. The police asked Tommy if he could identify the men as being involved in the brawl. He could. 20 minutes later, Another set of police officers brought Leon Easterling into the hospital room for Tommy to identify. He had no doubts that this man in the long leather jacket and diamond earring was the one who had stabbed him outside the MBTA public transport station on Tremont Street. At this hour, Tommy didn't know the extent of Andy's injuries. He was more worried about his father, an oral surgeon who worked upstairs at this very hospital, finding out that he'd been in the combat zone that night. He wondered if he might be able to keep it from him and asked one of the cops if the arrests would make the news. He recalled the way the cop looked at him, not bothering to mask his amusement. "Are you kidding?" he asked. "The whole world is going to know about this." As daybreak brought a dim gray light through the solarium windows, the Puopolo family jolted to attention. Three doctors entered the solarium. They had just come from the surgery. Dr. Joseph Amato took the lead and did all the talking. The family circled around him. Because of Tufts New England Medical Center's proximity to the combat zone, staff doctors saw a lot of gunshot and stab wounds and were considered the city's experts in the newly emerging field of combat medicine. Still, Dr. Amato, a cardiac and thoracic surgeon in his early 30s, expressed shock and disgust at how viciously Andy had been cut up. The first stabbing had punctured Andy's lung. The second attack penetrated his thick, muscled chest wall and gone deep into his heart. Andy had nearly bled to death and had arrived at the emergency room with no pulse. It was only because he was such a strong young athlete that doctors had been able to restart his heart. "Andy came back," Dr. Amato told them, in a tone of amazement. The young man's revival had impressed the entire medical team. Although the brain could only survive without oxygen for 5 to 6 minutes before sustaining permanent damage, doctors were optimistic. Andy's pupils had responded to light. He stood a good chance of recovery because of the fast action of the police, who had gotten him to the hospital within minutes of the stabbing. Dr. Amato told the family that they should go home and get sleep, or at least shower and eat something. Andy wouldn't be out of recovery for a while. None of them wanted to leave, Danny recalled. But after another hour or so, a new shift of nurses arrived and insisted it would be many, many hours before Andy regained consciousness. From the solarium window, Danny could see reporters below, already starting to gather with their notebooks and tape recorders. Television vans from all three of the Boston stations were parked on Harrison Avenue. The hospital administrator, a woman with glasses hanging from a chain around her neck, explained that they didn't have to talk to anyone in the media. Doctors would meet with the press to explain the medical procedures and update them on Andy's condition. Security would escort the family members directly to their cars so they would not be harassed. The family was still in shock, exhausted from anxiety and lack of sleep. They didn't understand why so many reporters were interested in Andy. Later, they would get used to the press waiting at the front door of the hospital, at their home, and at the courthouse. But that first morning, Danny would later recall, "We were just kind of numb. We didn't get that this wasn't even about my brother." That evening, the afternoon newspapers and all three local television stations featured the story. The next morning, and in the months to come, more than 300 newspapers, from as far away as Butte, Montana to Biddeford, Maine, including big city papers in Las Vegas and small town dailies from Indiana, Mississippi, and Texas, and even the Pacific Stars and Stripes in Japan, would report and follow the account of the two Harvard football players stabbed in Boston's combat zone. Many newspapers splashed photos of Andrew Puopolo and Thomas Lincoln across their front pages. The story had everything. Ivy League victims, prostitutes, and police heroes who saved a life by whisking a football hero to the nearest hospital in time to restart his heart. It was a cautionary tale about what happened when well-bred boys walked on the wild side. But it was also a story about Boston's social experiment. Across the nation, cities were dealing with what Time magazine had called America's Age of Porn in an April 1976 cover story titled The Porno Plague. Dominated by organized crime, pornography was a new and deeply controversial growth industry in a culture of rapidly changing social norms. There were two trends upsetting the public. The first was a new social acceptability of pornography in this era. Recent Supreme Court decisions had made it difficult to ban adult entertainment outright, and about 780 theaters in the nation were suddenly showing X-rated movies to growing audiences. The former prostitute Xaviera Hollander, best known for her memoir, The Happy Hooker, My Own Story, had sold 9 million copies of her numerous paperbacks. Linda Lovelace, of Deep Throat fame, had graced the cover of Esquire magazine. Penthouse publisher Bob Guccione had been honored at a fundraiser by Brandeis University. The second trend getting attention was the increasingly violent content of these films. Graphic sadomasochism, S&M plots, included rape, murder, and decapitation as part of the sexual thrill. The 1975 film Story of O featured sexual abuse and whipping of a woman by multiple men. In 1976, Snuff, a softcore film with a Charles Manson cult-inspired plot in which a woman was sawed to pieces, purported to include a real-life murder. Although it turned out to be a marketing hoax, the film galvanized feminists who picketed the film across the nation. Feminists objected to this flood of violent pornography as anti-female. Pornography, like rape, is a male invention designed to dehumanize women, to reduce the female to an object of sexual access, wrote the feminist Susan Brownmiller, author of the 1975 book Against Our Will. But everyone got involved in the discussion. English professors, social psychologists, political scientists, psychiatrists, First Amendment advocates, and even Playboy publisher Hugh Hefner weighed in on where this new pornography was taking the nation, with comparisons made to the fall of the Roman Empire. Cities across America scrambled as officials tried to figure out how to cope with the sleazy new industry overtaking their downtowns. It wasn't just a morality play. In the mid-1970s, cities across the nation struggled in the recession. Only the year before, the nation's largest and richest city, New York, billions in debt, had teetered on the brink of bankruptcy, forcing massive municipal cutbacks that were epitomized by the tons of rotting garbage that piled up on city streets. Boston wasn't doing much better. The proliferating X-rated bookstores and theaters in the heart of the downtown area hardly improved property values. Boston's solution to the pornography problem, the combat zone, both fascinated and rankled the nation. Ironically, the puritanical city, best known for banning everything from Walt Whitman's poetry collection Leaves of Grass in 1882 to the 1967 Swedish film I Am Curious Yellow, had decided to officially zone an adult entertainment district. The official zoning was actually a containment strategy meant to appease the city's more well-to-do neighborhoods by limiting the industry to that four-block area. But it was widely viewed as progressive. To critics of the plan, and there were many within the city as well, this official zoning only made the problem worse by condoning a new social acceptability of sleaze. A story about the stabbing of two Harvard football players, proved just how misguided that social acceptability really was. The sensational fact that the victims were white Harvard students and the suspects identified as black pimps didn't hurt newspaper sales either. Chapter 3: A Sexual Disneyland. In a straight-laced city like Boston, where puritanical actually meant founded by Puritans, the existence of a red-light district downtown had always been rife with conflict. Boston had managed to rid itself of its original red-light district, Scully Square, by bulldozing the area of barrooms and burlesque halls in the early 1960s to make way for the new government center. But Boston would soon learn that when it came to adult entertainment, city planning was no match for market forces. Lower Washington and its side streets, an area of low-rent storefronts and deteriorating old theaters about a dozen blocks away, provided inexpensive real estate for the setup of newer, more risque strip clubs, modern X-rated movie houses, adult bookstores, and the innovative coin-operated peep shows of the era. The essence of Scully Square, also known as the Crossroads of Hell, would evolve with the times, growing wilder and more dangerous in its new location. The new neighborhood had informally been called the Combat Zone since the 1950s because of all the uniformed soldiers and sailors who hung out in its bars and nightclubs and got into street fights. A 1964 exposé by Gene Cole and other reporters at the Record American about rising crime in the new red light district got the credit for making the nickname stick. By the 1970s, 12 strip clubs and a total of more than 35 sex entertainment businesses operated in the combat zone. Terrified that the flourishing sex industry would spill into nicer neighborhoods and sully upscale Back Bay or Beacon Hill, city officials felt the need to act. Demolishing buildings clearly hadn't worked, and federal high court decisions regarding First Amendment rights in the early 1970s prevented the city from banning these businesses. The city's novel response the following fall, approving a zoning amendment to officially establish the four-block area for adult entertainment next to Chinatown, which had little political voice and was promised a thriving restaurant climate, as well as two new housing projects for not objecting, according to Michael Liu's Forever Struggle, Activism, Identity, and Survival in Boston's Chinatown, 1880 to 2018. The housing projects, along with other promises by the Boston Redevelopment Authority to dress up the neighborhood, never materialized. But meanwhile, the sex industry swiftly boomed. Mixed among the topless bars, strip clubs, peep shows, and X-rated movie houses was a gay bathhouse, the occasional drag show, and gay hookup spots. Soon, the Wall Street Journal would describe Boston's adult entertainment district as a sexual Disneyland. The zone wasn't devoid of social value. In fact, it was known as a refuge for the offbeat, artistic, and liberal-minded, one of the few places in the 1970s where gays were accepted, where blacks and whites drank at the same bar, and where an interracial couple could share an apartment without rocks coming through the window. The area, a hotspot for big band, jump, jazz, and rock and roll in the 1950s and early 1960s, featured live music throughout the 1970s, making it a haven for young musicians. But if the zone came of age in an era of cultural revolution, it also came of age in an era of urban poverty and escalating crime. The national recession hit Boston hard at a time when violent crime had more than quadrupled between 1960 and 1970. In the combat zone, crime wasn't just up. It was in your face. On weekend nights in 1976, as many as 60 streetwalkers clogged the short block of LaGrange Street outside Good Time Charlie's. The pimped-out Cadillacs lined up one after another on the streets, according to former Combat Zone police detective Billy Dwyer. Sexual encounters could be had in the back rooms of certain clubs, in X-rated theaters, in the alleys and parking lots. One nightclub even found a way to let customers charge oral sex on credit cards. On weekends, suburban clients showed up, driving around the block, the drive-through, as it was called, until it was their turn to pick up pot or cocaine from corner dealers. Nearly everything was a cash transaction, and nearly everyone was high on something. Wallets were ripe for picking. Garrett Byrne, a six-term district attorney for Suffolk County, which has jurisdiction over Boston, had led the office since the end of World War II. An ardent opponent of the combat zone and an unapologetic prude, he maintained an activist vice squad that raided every porn house and bookstore in search of obscenity violations. But the city of Boston was decidedly less aggressive in policing liquor violations, prostitution, or street crime. A public outcry occasionally led to a crackdown, but often the police appeared nonchalant. Some believed that Boston's lax policing of the combat zone was simply benign neglect. After all, the city grudgingly provided vital services, including street maintenance and building code inspection, in this part of town. Others attributed the neglect to embarrassment, as if by ignoring the combat zone, the city could negate its existence. But most saw it as license, an anything-goes policy, as long as anything stayed in the zone. As it turned out, it was a kind of license, although not official and not from the city itself. Police weren't just lax in the zone, as many complained. They were utterly corrupt. The public learned about it from the police commissioner himself. Robert DeGrazia, a controversial radical reformer who had led police departments in the San Francisco area and St. Louis County, Missouri, had been recruited in 1972 to clean up the city's police department. At 6 feet four, he was ruggedly handsome and welcomed public speaking. He quickly made his voice heard throughout the city. In an interview shortly before he passed away in 2018, DeGrazia said that while he had known he was hired to tackle corruption, he was still surprised to discover the extent of it. Soon after his arrival, he became convinced that Boston had the most corrupt police force in the entire nation. District 1, which included the combat zone, the North End, the waterfront, and Back Bay, was the epicenter of that corruption. In a historic 1919 police strike, the entire Boston police force had been replaced with young recruits, all about the same age. Since then, nearly the entire force had retired and was replaced, pretty much in unison. In the early 1970s, the members of the force were, on average, 44 years old, the oldest force of any major city in the nation, and deeply entrenched in the status quo. The new-to-town police commissioner supported the 1974 zoning change that gave the combat zone its official status, with the understanding that the zoning change would be coupled with radical reform in District 1. But reform wasn't easy for DeGrazia, who was the first non-Irish police commissioner in the city's modern era. Many in the rank and file didn't like him and considered him a grandstander. As an outsider, he soon found himself navigating a labyrinth of political connections and one of the most militant police unions in the nation. He decided that he needed proof to demote and replace a corrupt command and ordered a secret investigation into daily operations in District 1. That secret investigation lasted more than 33 months. DeGrazia was a man not afraid to make headlines, perhaps too many headlines. In the 1975 mayoral election, The new police commissioner's extreme popularity with voters was noted as a factor in Kevin White's re-election. Shortly after the election, the mayor asked DeGrazia to a breakfast meeting to smoke out his police chief's political ambitions. Despite DeGrazia's assurances that he had no interest in challenging the mayor in the next election, the relationship between the men deteriorated. DeGrazia said he felt the mayor's cold shoulder keenly. He accepted a new job in Maryland. After delaying the results of the secret investigation for more than a year, DeGrazia said he began to worry that it would never get publicized. A week before his departure for Maryland, the police commissioner released the report directly to the Boston Globe and the Boston Herald American, which was what it was then. It didn't appear coincidental that he chose a day that the mayor was out of town. These were the peak earning years of the Mafia's Angiulo crime family, which controlled gambling and prostitution in Boston. 4 years after the first Godfather movie was released, Boston mobsters were flush with glamour and payoff money. According to DeGrazia, at least half of all the cops who policed the combat zone were on the take. Known as the Special Investigation Unit, SIU report, the 572-page secret document conservatively estimated that at least 40% of the adult entertainment businesses in the combat zone were mob-owned, according to the Boston Globe, which did a comprehensive spread on the report. It exposed both trivial and wide-scale corruption and broke it all down in painstaking detail. One of DeGrazia's earliest actions in District 1 had been to end the popular practice of allowing police to make extra money working detail for the combat zone clubs. Critics, and there were many, complained that the policy change reduced the number of uniformed police in the combat zone, which led to the spike in crime. But the SIU report made clear that the detail work, bought and paid for by the nightclubs, had compromised the police. The Boston Globe's partial text of the SIU report revealed that investigators witnessed unnamed police officers drinking for free at the combat zone bars and strip clubs, off duty and on. Patrolmen ignored obvious liquor violations, bookie operations, prostitution, public sex acts, and drug sales. They were witnessed standing idly on the street as the street hookers stopped traffic and reached into cars to fondle men's genitals. The police allowed mobsters to double park throughout the zone and waterfront. But much worse, they sabotaged their own department's investigations by tipping off organized crime in advance, the report stated. In the ultimate symbol of corruption, District 1 police had provided an escort for the funeral cortege of mob leader Gennaro Angiulo's mother, with one of the city's top commanders directing the traffic himself and serving as an honor guard. In fact, the SIU report charged that police raided only low-level street bookies, prostitutes, and pimps when they needed to divert attention from mafia-run crime or when forced to put up crime numbers to appease a public outcry. Six officers were reported to have extorted sex from combat zone prostitutes. In one particularly cruel expression of the city's racism, two of these officers, dubbed the Golden Boys, concluded a forced sexual encounter with a black prostitute by shoving her out of the car in the all-white and notoriously hostile Southie, blowing the horn as they sped away. The SIU report also drew attention to the growing problem of a pickpocketing scheme that had been plaguing the zone for several years. It described wolf packs of young women dressed as prostitutes and sometimes referred to as whorelets. They lifted wallets as they fondled the men leaving the clubs in an apparent solicitation. Key details from this report about how the scheme had evolved would influence the prosecution of the Harvard football player stabbing. Most notably, a new element that developed in 1974. Male protectors showed up and started working with the young women to rob the men. The report explained that these protectors stepped in if the victims became too vocal about being robbed or struggled to get away. They would typically loudly charge that the theft victim had insulted the girls and would attack or rob the victims themselves. Investigators called it the robber whore scheme. In a 2017 interview, DeGrazia revealed that he knew of several cops who participated in the scheme itself by looking the other way in return for a cut of the stolen wallet. One of the most depressing revelations about the Boston Police Department in those days was how little it cost to buy a cop, DeGrazia said. Clean cops. And he estimated that about half of the force in District 1 was clean, were deeply discouraged. The morale of the Boston force was at an all-time low. Dumped on the city as the commissioner made his exit, the SIU report elicited both praise and criticism, with some calling it a vindictive parting shot at the mayor. Although the report identified 20 separate instances of police misconduct, it was designed to identify wide patterns of corruption rather than provide evidence for prosecuting dirty cops. It did not name names and led to few prosecutions, but its timing was pivotal. So swiftly followed by the stabbings of the two Harvard football players and the death of an off-duty state trooper after a fistfight in the zone later the very same week, DeGrazia's SIU report led to citywide consensus. Crime in the combat zone was out of control. The city could no longer turn a blind eye, or even a nearsighted one. Something had to be done. To say that Boston police in District 1 were in need of some positive press would be an understatement. At a press conference the morning after the two Harvard football players were stabbed, Sergeant Frank Sullivan stood at the podium before a standing-room-only crowd of print, radio, and television reporters with tales of heroics and other good news to share. Tommy Lincoln, whose wounds were not life-threatening, would be out of the hospital by the weekend. The prognosis for Andy Puopolo was hopeful. And best of all, doctors gave full credit to police for their fast action. As the cameras clicked and reporters scribbled into their notebooks, Sullivan explained why he had defied a standing department order that required him to wait for an ambulance to transport a victim, and instead sent Andy to the hospital in the patrol wagon. "If I had waited for an ambulance," he told the press, "the kid would have died in the street." That quote would be repeated in early and late editions, on radio shows and television that evening and the next day. Police had gotten Andy to the emergency room in under 6 minutes. It was only because of this smart and speedy delivery that doctors could resuscitate his heart and repair it. "He's a lucky kid," Dr. David Rosenthal told reporters. He was the doctor on Tufts staff who had sewn up the hole in Andy's heart and restored his blood pressure. "I've known very few who have come back after that." The new police commissioner, Joseph Jordan, had been sworn in just the day before, but also got credit. One of his first acts had been to beef up the police presence in the combat zone. This was the reason the police were able to swarm the area within seconds of the fight. Not only had police saved the Harvard student's life, they managed to arrest not one, but three men from Boston for the crime. Leon Easterling, 41, Richard Allen, 36, and Edward J. Suarez, 33. Although witness statements identified Leon Easterling as the only one who stabbed both football players, Sergeant Sullivan made clear that all three men were equally at fault. All three men were charged with assault and battery with a deadly weapon, as if they had all thrust the knife. Why all three? Sullivan explained that the Harvard boys were the latest victims of the robber whore operation that reporters in the room already knew was a chronic combat zone problem. It was so chronic that the New York Times had reported on it. It was so long-lasting that local strip clubs and even other prostitutes had complained about it because it took cash out of men's pockets and was bad for their business. The defendants, who would be identified as pimps in some of the later stories, were initially called protectors in this first press conference. When one reporter asked if the wallet had been stolen during a solicitation of a prostitute, Sullivan waved off that suggestion, according to the Boston Globe reporting. There was absolutely no prostitution involved. The crime was pure larceny. They do it a lot. They grab you, you get all excited, and zing, your wallet's gone, he explained. As reporters attended press conferences, the Puopolo family returned home to Jamaica Plain. Nobody could sleep, Danny recalled. The doctors had told them that the first few hours would be crucial for Andy, and they wanted to be there when he awoke. They showered, attempted to eat breakfast, and drove back to the hospital. That morning, doctors had been optimistic in interviews with the press. The knife wounds had just missed the heart's delicate network of nerve fibers that controlled Andy's heartbeat. And while there were risks to the brain when it was deprived of oxygen, they had a hunch that Andy's brain was not damaged. Early signs were encouraging. But by the time the family returned to the solarium, doctors had revised their prognosis. Dr. Joseph Amato and Dr. Richard Cleveland, the chief surgeon, greeted the Puopolos.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.